Hello to everybody again. Nice to see you online, but I prefer to meet you all at the real conference in Chisinau and to discuss always like we are doing in the framework of the International Conference on Nanotechnologies and Biomedical Engineering. So we are still all real people. So first of all, I would like to thank the organizers, but most important is to congratulate them, Professor Shontia and Professor Tigineanu, academician. We've excellent organized conference. I attended really almost all sections and all presentations were of high quality and all professors showed really interesting results. So this means these two professors, they really devoted themselves to organize this conference, the fifth one, but the first one was here in 2011, and we can see Professor Shontia organizing first conference together with Professor Tigineanu, and of course, most important or the main results of such conferences are meeting other people. So meeting other people during all this conference, for example, I just met shortly Professor Radelung, which changed really a lot of things in my life, for example. But I want to say that Professor Shontia was the person who invited me at the Technical University and convinced me not to go to work in industry, but to stay at the department. And next academician Tigineanu also directed my life, so he convinced me to go even further with research, not to stay only on PhD, but to go with habilitation, to accept some positions at different universities around the world. Even if I had already a good offer from other countries, from the US, for example, I was spending half of the year always there. Also, these two professors, they really influenced positively my life, for example, and not only mine, but for a lot of young people who decided to devote themselves to science. Of course, we have to acknowledge the organizing committee of this conference. So it was the chief professor, associate professor Raelian, with his team, they did really a nice and the hard work to make it possible to have this first conference online. And it was really, it's excellently organized, in my opinion. How these two professors changed my life, so you can see it here. So I decided to continue in science, then I liked it. Started to write a lot of papers, receiving a lot of citations. And even if you will go to Web of Science, you will see a sign here where it is marked highly cited. So not so many researchers can do it, but we can do it. Main fields are indicated, for example, on Google Scholar, on my web page, or on Web of Science. Now Scopus also is pointing which directions are doing any researchers. So this is important for the young people. I suppose now are listening a lot of our students also, so they can see an example how they have to listen to professors, not just to go somewhere to work in some companies for a little bit of more money, but you can do a lot of changes in your life and help also your country. So also by hard work and in collaborations with these two professors, I came on the top 1% by citations for 2018 and cross field. It was generated for the first time, also received laureate of a national prize from the government of the Republic of Moldova. And where I getting so much inspirations and so on, not only in the lab. I spent a lot of time, so my postdoc was in Paris and at the University of Central Florida in the USA. So you know that in Paris really exists a lot of museums. So I spent for a curiosity, I spent more than three complete weeks in my life in these museums. So, you know, but in Paris exists this, the largest museum called Louvre, also Orsay. They are so beautiful, so nice. So I spend the entire day, or at least one day per month in these museums and admiring all things done by our previous generations. And after this, for example, you can do your work in the lab much more easily. For example, first paper in advanced materials, you know, it's really hard to go in this journal, but I wrote it in 2 or 3 days. And it was accepted in 2 or 3 weeks in this journal. And now it came to highly cited, so it contributed to this. Other works also with our universities helped here. So where I am now, I am at the Department of Microelectronics and Biomedical Engineering, Faculty of Computer Informatics and Microelectronics at the Technical University of Moldova. So strong collaborations and everyday connection with different universities in Germany, USA, France, England, Russian Academy of Science, Ukraine, Romania, and so on, many one. And why we are microelectronics and biomedical engineering. So our main specialty or our main program at the department is microelectronics and nanotechnologies now. It was microelectronics and semiconductor devices, which I graduated. And that's why, because of microelectronics, we can speak now online. If no microelectronics, we could not do nothing now. Also, this microelectronics affects and really change the applied electronics currently. So that's why we received at our department a new program, Applied Electronics, which is totally different. So we are training young people how to make it. And we have very good professors, young professors now in this field. And the most important is biomedical engineering, which was developed or was promoted by the professor Shontia at the Technical University of Moldova and our department. He was, and he is the head of this program. Also, biomedical engineering is not possible without microelectronics and even information technologies and other fields. So that's why we have to be all together and to do a hard work and research and science at the Technical University. So Technical University is the only one high educational institution accredited by the government, by the Republic of Moldova. It's something like Ecole Polytechnique. And everybody knows that Ecole Polytechnique, the most powerful, how to say, university or institutes around the world. You saw in my affiliations also University of Central Florida and our university. So I am courtesy appointment professor at the University of Central Florida, elected by for 5 years, invited professor at the UCL University, number one in France, invited professor and scientist at the Kiel University. At the CNRS, we are inviting once per year, once or two times also, as an expert at the European Science Foundation. Our department had some history. I will not stop too long, but started from the industrial electronics department. Then it formed the second department, physics of materials and semiconductor devices. Next, it came to department of microelectronics and semiconductor devices by combining these two departments. And currently, it's Department of Microelectronics and Biomedical Engineering. It was changed. Professor Shontia did it. Here are department chairs of all this. So I started, for example, somewhere here when Professor Shishiano was the department chair. Also, he was my scientific advisor for the PhD thesis. And next department chair for this period was Professor Shont. These two professors also really changed and formed my character. Maybe somebody don't like it, but I'm like I am. So this is life. Which programs we are covering and how many professors we have at the department? We have about 36 employees, so around 10 associate professors, 10 professors, 3 academicians, and offering programs for microelectronics, nanotechnology, biomedical engineering for the bachelor, the same for the master studies, and for PhD, we can offer to everybody who are interested 5 different specialties or 5 different profiles in applied physics. We have physics and technology of materials, physics of nanosystems and nanotechnologies. We have nano microelectronics and optoelectronics pieces more related to engineering and other 2 specialties. We have a series of labs at the department, and of course, Professor Schwanter contributed a lot with his team to develop and form new laboratories. And of course, research centers. So at the department, we have also 3 centers associated. Here some images of real life. So this was real only 2 years ago. So you can see that people no masks, we can sit together, they can organize nice conferences. So it was real. And Professor Schwanter was always in, and it is always the heart of our department. And not only department, but you can see the entire faculty is attached to him and is learning from his activities and from his behavior, everything what is positively. And I really learned from this Professor Schwanter, Professor Tiginiano, and my colleagues a lot in my life. So let's go back now to the research, what we are doing. So this year I selected this the new topic about 3D printed sensors of nanostructured semiconducting oxides. Previously, I was showing you results about our nanosensors mainly. So, but I will do it next time at the next edition of the international conference. Main contributors or the main teams are our team from Moldova and the team of Professor Radelung from Kiel University and postdoc Leonard Siebert. Of course, our teams. So short introduction, manufacturing first principles, new approaches, I will show you shortly, integration of nanomaterials and printed sensors, performances, and short conclusions of our research. Why we are studying so many sensors? Why? Because the detection of biological and chemical species is central to many different fields of indoor or outdoor safety. Also for healthcare is very important. For diagnostics is very important. Where I use sensors everywhere for positioning, for proximity, for presence, you need it, for motion or velocity, for temperature detection and monitoring, for humidity, for acoustic or sound or different vibrations. We also need sensors, chemical detection, gas sensing, flow, force, load, leaks or levels. This is really very important. Electrical, magnetic and accelerometer and a lot of our daily life require different high quality sensors. And since we are at the conference, it's really important to mention that sensors are very, very important for biomedical engineering because, for example, physician or caregiver, they want to monitor patient health situation. What's it? So they are placing different types of these sensors which can communicate. So in this case, we need a sensor node. So already with electronics here should be, and with a high quality electronics, not only sensor, which can communicate with networks to send all this information to healthcare server and it go or to physician or to caregiver, or if something emergency, then it goes to emergency centers. Also, it is very important for researchers, for medical researchers and everything can best to go back with a biofeedback. So sensors are important, but how to make them? We develop different approaches, different nanotechnologies, nanosensors, and so on. But always the problem is cost or before implementation, before applying all this in industry. It's important cost per part. If you make some really easy shape or easy complex geometry of the sensors, then cost is still low. But if complexity goes high, then complexity is increasing, the price goes higher and higher. And in this way, it is important to develop new approaches. So one of this is additive. So for example, with additive, you can construct different types, different shapes of these sensors. And in this case, we can see a lowering in the cost per part. Next, if you go even to a more complex devices already, then it can go even to some barrier, but we can overcome this by developing something new. So by applying self-organization. So now you can solve self-assemblies and other approaches are used, technological approaches are used to develop new devices. So how to make it? It's, for example, create some nucleation points, then you can make some inhibition zone, create more of them, inhibit, and in this way can be constructed different shaped and at a really low cost per part devices, including sensors. So we can see here. By combining these complex applications, we can develop 3D printing. So we can see the same nanowires, which I used previously, for example, in single nanowire nanosensors. Here we're trying to reduce the price of the device or cost of one device. And more details about this can be found in our recent works with Dr. Ziebert and Professor Adelung in nanoenergy and supply materials about additive manufacturing. So for example, if we have some undefined mixture of gases, for example, then what's hazard and hazard concentrations and so on, how it can be identified. It can be printed, for example, different types of sensors arrays, sensor one, material two, and so on. We have a lot of PhD students and everyone is working with different materials. So it can be developed something like an array. You can make, for example, for only one compound. So it will work something like a fingerprint for one type of gas or one type of compound for second one. If you combine, then you can make a device and a device for many different types. How it looks, this first 3D printed and our work, they are looking something like this. We picked up some metal microparticles. First, the easiest one was the copper with diameters 1 to 10 micrometers. Then Leo was working really a lot on this topic. He developed this 3D printer for this type, and it was possible to realize by exchanging ideas, we made it. So how it can be controlled? Yes, it can be controlled by knowing these technological parameters. So for example, you can change the pressure here. You can change the diameters of these particles. You need a special diameter or radius of this syringe. And also it is a dependence between the flux of this microparticles flow and pressure and diameter and so on. So these are equations which Leo presented and his PhD thesis and some of joint papers. So for example, small radius, it's good for higher resolution. If you want to print something higher, that is to prevent the mixing particles, higher pressure, delta P is necessarily, and so on. So in this way can be printed, for example, different types of different diameters, different shapes, and so on of material. So here, for example, we have some zinc oxide printing. Next, after printing, we are printing only metal particles by using some previously developed technological approaches for oxidizing these particles. We found that annealing at 400 can create such types of bridging between nanoparticles, so really tiny nanowires, which are interpenetrated, so create a current flow through this network. So in this way, by combining these two techniques, additive manufacturing, self-organizations, we made first device. Also, Leo and his team and the group of Professor Radelung are working on different types of other materials, for example, zinc oxide. Zinc oxide for UV sensor CNTs, it can be used for the conductor. Copper we published for gas sensing, mixing copper and iron for gas sensing. Also can be printed iron for magnets and so on. Any ideas can be now explored and reported. Of course, first devices printed show some response, but we are always proposing some mechanism which explain why this is good. So these types of sensors were good for acetone. So here was involved also our PhD students, Nikolai and Nikolai. So we observed that at different operating temperatures, we can control the gas response. For example, at 300 is the lowest, but if we go to 350 already, it shows a sensor behavior. By increasing it's in the even higher response of these devices. CNTs can be printed, we explain, and by combining with zinc oxide, it can be made some UV sensors and it can be flexible. So in this way it can be printed. If you need more details about this, you can find the nanoenergy, also nanoenergy. This is our printer, a lot of websites and even Ministry of Research of Germany, they published our photo and our results about this research. But we moved forward with this technique. So now we are trying to develop some sensors for battery. Now you know that everybody is moving to electrical cars, but these cars have huge batteries. And if some leakage of gases or something, it can be really catastrophic. So that's why it's important. Here we published some recent results with our group in Moldova and group of Professor Radel here. Invited paper. But next, of course, we are doing all characterizations. I will not stop at each one. Of course, we need to do XRD, we need to do Raman, we need to do XPS to identify which crystal phases we have, how we can control the properties of these devices, and so on. So all this is done and explained. Due to lack of time, I will not stop. So, of course, we studied a mixture with different gases and we found the most selective to acetone. Why acetone? Acetone is important for diabetic monitoring. So if we can really produce such types of sensors and to make it even much more selective, then by integrated in an electronic node, we have our young PhD students coming soon. They will try to implement these electronic nodes and include sensors. And we next can monitor, if, for example, in hospitals and so on, because different professors from different countries, they already asked, can we study this? I have permission and so on. So this is our next target for application. Another approach of the same techniques, we used copper oxide with iron oxide. So this one is a p-type semiconducting oxide, p-type behavior. This one is this one is p-type, this one is n-type. In this case we have pn, combination of pn materials, which helped us to reduce the power consumption, because if we want to implement such types of sensors in an electronic node and monitor something continuously, then it's much better to have the lowest power consumption And this way, it can work longer with the same battery, for example, but also can help monitoring of the patient. Here you can see some examples how we made first devices. So we, if somebody will decide or some companies will decide to use it, we have it developed so we can make a really big production of such types of sensors. Also, we observed that such types can be even suspended, flexible, 3D printed copper iron sensor. So you can see, even if we have nanowires, they are really hard, strong materials. You see, few nanowires can hold big microparticles of this metal on top. So we can create this flexible research on this is in progress. We already have some results. So devices are working, also depends on the different extension and so on. All experiments are done, but it will be reported later. As I mentioned, we did all characterizations for these materials, copper, copper, iron mixture and so on, identified all crystal phases and also even some metal traces and these materials. Detailed analysis by TEM was done, confirming observations from the XRD purity of this, because it's important to study the surface of these materials after printing, if we don't have some other traces, and it was found only copper and iron. Here more performances of these sensors, copper iron mixture, 3D printed. Also, this type of devices showed a good selectivity to acetone vapors, but we can see here saturation after high concentrations of higher than 100 ppm acetone. Concentrations already is saturation of this device, but we are interested, for example, for biomedical engineering, we are interested somewhere in this region. So we tested below 1 ppm and we already observed that devices are working. With increasing concentrations, it can show an increase in these devices. Still more work to be done here. Also, power was reduced below 1 microwatt for such types of sensor mixing, and response was increasing. Showing electrical characteristics and so on with these properties. Also, with our PhD students, we tried to make maybe even an easy way to fabricate devices. So we just picked up a single microwire of copper, placed here some copper microparticles, used the same annealing approach and obtained something like this for a shell structure, and all detailed characteristics I will not stop here. And we found that such types, for example, of sensors can work like 3-in-1. For example, at room temperature, it is a good detector of 2-propanol. If we increase temperature, for example, 255, we can detect ethanol, but if we go to high temperatures, then we can detect hydrogen. So, for example, such types of simple developed sensors can be used for 3-in-1 and are quite stable also on time. We can see it here. Of course, it was proposed and published the sensing mechanism, some theoretical calculations, why it's good for ethanol, why it's good for propanol. All this was done and reported. This part, we involved some teams from the UK, from India, from Netherlands, and different groups. And if someone can and like to do this, we are really open for collaboration in this field also. If somebody can be involved in computations and to develop this new and explain new mechanisms. If we compare developed sensors, they are in the same range or even much higher and much better than reported ones with most recent literature. So And a short conclusion, we can see that sensors, if we use only copper, it's a good for hydrogen at this temperature. If we want acetone sensors, then we have to use copper mixture with iron oxides. Copper, it's a good for acetone. If we go for room temperature with microwire, we can get 2-propanol or ethanol sensors. So I want to say thank you to project supporting us, different projects, also to our PhD students from Moldova involved. So they are doing science, but they, even Vasily received his recent PhD, Nikolai has defended already first one at the department. Now Nikolai is the next one. And all of them received their fellowships from the government of the Republic of Moldova as an excellent PhD student. As I mentioned, we are not doing only research, but also we try to implement all these devices and real ones and to make it functional. So here we have some examples of nanosensors, but we have young PhD students which are developing now electronic nodes, and we will show soon much more interesting results. Our team, of course, Professor Shontia was always supporting us and involved in collaborations and everything with our team. Here are names I will not talk. Of course, Professor Adelung team. I want to mention that he has more than 20 PhD students. So it's really hard work, and more than 8 postdocs. So it's not so easy, but he can do it. He's a strong and always generating new ideas, and can guide all these young people to get their PhD. Of course, acknowledgements to Professor Kinley team, to Professor Fowfield team and others which are involved. And at the end, at this conference, we are always going to Krikova when it was a real life. Professor Shontia publishing all books and Springer, all our publications with Professor Homin. We are here at the Krikova. So if you want to know, in Moldova, we have 2 largest in the old wine cellars. One is in Krikova, and then one is in Miller. So we have about 120 kilometers underground, and temperature is always constant. And after this conference, we are always on visit here. It's really interesting, real life. I hope we'll come back soon to real life. And I want just to say that we are now collaborating with different current countries and research groups. So of course, I hope we can cover entire planet with our collaborations. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much indeed for your very nice presentation, very detailed, and the finalization of your presentation with the sealer, so with of wines, so virtually, but so we are feeling the smell. So thank you very much indeed. So now, please, our session is open for the questions. And again, it is my appeal: just ask the question and feel free to ask, because I don't see everybody on my screen. Please ask the question. No questions. Okay, Professor Lupan, thank you very much indeed.